1. Stans act like a budget version of Minhyejin. I mean, why y'all are accusing XG of copying Aespa? Aespa's fans are on a roll, accusing every group under the sun of plagiarizing Aespa. It's almost as if they've got a checklist for every new group that pops up. Futuristic concept? Sci-fi vibes? Must be an Aespa copycat. They even accused 17 of stealing Aespa's concept. Girl, what? The idea that 17, a group that's been around the block and has its own distinct style, is somehow part of a grand conspiracy to rip off Aespa's concept is laughable. They're not even shopping in the same concept store. And XG? Sure, they've got their futuristic alien thing going on, but accusing them of plagiarism is a stretch wider than the galaxy they're supposedly borrowing from. The irony is that Aespa themselves faced backlash for plagiarizing KDA and others during debut. Double standards much? Some fans seem to be stuck in a time loop, reliving Aespa's controversies and lashing out at other groups to make themselves feel better. But why the insecurity? Aespa's doing great, so why the need to drag others? Plus, XG was out there doing the alien thing before Aespa added it to their lore. So what's the fuss about? And sure, Aespa nailed their unique image and aesthetic, props to them for that. But claiming they're the first and only ones to rock that style is like saying they invented the color black. Newsflash, they didn't. And other groups can vibe with futuristic concepts without it being called a copycat. Trying to argue with Aespa's fans is like trying to win a race against a bullet train. They've got the girls' achievements locked and loaded, ready to fire at anyone who dares to question Aespa's originality. But here's the thing. XG did the alien concept first. Aespa's lore might have taken a turn into alien futuristic territory, but that doesn't mean they own the concept. 2. I've had it with these knockoff hip-hop groups. I want to talk about the upcoming girl group Bad Villain. They released teasers and performance videos, and they were questionable to say the least. The whole hip-hop act that's popping up in K-pop is out of place and kinda sad. This new group, Bad Villain, is just the latest to jump on the bandwagon, and it's not a good look. First off, the whole I'm so hood spiel is worn out. It's like they picked up a hip-hop dictionary and decided to use every word without understanding the meaning. When they're rapping about spinning the block, it's hard not to roll your eyes. In one of their performances on YouTube, one of the girls was literally rapping saying, "Spin the block, block, block," like, "What block are we spinning, mama?" The only block she's spinning is the one in Minecraft. Even their name is weird. Bad Villain? The name alone screams we're edgy, but not really. I mean, what's next? Lil Gangster Kittens? Thug Puppies? Why people still have this stereotypical about what hip-hop is? It's 2024, for goodness sake, and the fashion in their teasers and performances? Don't get me started, the veils, the bandanas, it's like a costume party where the theme is hip-hop, but nobody did their homework. It's like they raided a costume shop, found the hip-hop starter pack, and thought, yep, this is my new aesthetic, but when you peel back the layers, you realize they're cosplaying hip-hop, it's all surface-level swagger. It's a shallow mimicry that misses the depth and reality of the culture they're trying to emulate. These idols were hip-hop like a rented tuxedo, but ask them about the genre's history, and they'll stare at you like you just asked for their social security number. Swag and hood are their go-to vocabulary, but ask them to break down a hip-hop verse? Crickets, the disconnection is real, they're cosplaying a life they don't lead, and it shows. It's hard to vibe with music that feels like a facade. Real hip-hop is raw and authentic, not a caricature with grills and bandanas. It's about storytelling, not just throwing around words like hook and swag, and the cultural appropriation is a whole other level of mess. It's one thing to appreciate a culture, but it's another to disrespect it. The industry needs to do better, learn the history, understand the significance, and show some respect. It's not that hard. It's a shame because there's potential for idols to rap about real issues, like the grind of being a trainee and the pressures of idol life. That's something people can relate to, something genuine. But instead here they are rapping about how hood they are. 3. Y'all know nothing about what self-produced actually mean. The term self-produced is getting tossed around like a hot potato. As soon as an idol write a line or two, everyone's screaming self-produced from the rooftops. But that's not what I'm focusing on today. I want to talk about the misconception people have about true self-produced groups. Fans think that for a group to be self-produced, they have to do everything on their own, from lyrics to production to everything. But at what point in time did the term self-produced evolve to imply that no external producers should have any involvement in the creation of the music? So, your faves have a couple of extra names on the production credits, and suddenly they're not self-produced? That's just petty. It's like saying you didn't cook dinner because you didn't invent the recipe. Music isn't made in a vacuum. It's about collaboration, and this whole idea that self-produced means zero outside help? That's just bonkers. Even the most indie bands have someone mastering their tracks or throwing in a riff or two. These idols are part of a bigger machine, and that's not something to scoff at. Sure, not every artist is a jack of all trades, spinning the decks and penning every lyric, but to strip them of the self-produced title because they're not a one-person band? That's just snobbery. Making music is a group effort. It's about having a significant hand in the pie, not baking the whole darn thing alone. 4. Not every idol needs an Ariana Grande voice. Sure, Ariana Grande's vocal range can shatter glass, but not every idol needs to hit those stratospheric notes to be considered a great singer. High notes are impressive, they're like vocal fireworks, but they doesn't automatically make you a vocal prodigy. It's like thinking a car is fast just because it has a loud engine. It's not all about the noise, it's about how you use it. Sure, hitting those sky-high pitches can be a showstopper, but it's not the be-all and end-all of singing. Think about it. If singing was just about screeching out high notes, then every karaoke bar would be full of superstars, but it's not. Vocal range is just one piece of the puzzle. You've got to have the control, the emotion, and the ability to tell a story with your voice. That's what separates the one-hit wonders from the legends. And let's talk about those high notes that sound like a cat on a hot tin roof. Just because you can reach the stratosphere doesn't mean you should. Sometimes, it's the subtlety in the lower register, the warmth and richness that really gets the goosebumps going. So to all the fans out there who think their fave is the GOAT because they can shatter glass with their voice, chill, music is an art, not a screaming competition. And to those who are quick to dismiss a singer because they can't hit the high C, maybe broaden your horizons. There's a whole world of musicality and expression that goes beyond just flexing your vocal cords. 5. K-pop and J-pop aren't music genres, they're industries. The music industry's got this obsession with compartmentalization, like everything's gotta fit neatly into a box. But here's the deal, music's not a set of drawers where you can just file away sounds under K for Korean or J for Japanese. It's more fluid than that. Music's become a melting pot, artists are mixing it up, borrowing beats, and singing in whatever language fits the vibe. It's a mashup culture, and it's giving us some killer tracks, so why are we still trying to separate them like they're from different planets? Take a look at K-pop. It's not just about catchy hooks anymore. These groups are genre-bending wizards, throwing in a bit of rap, EDM, and who knows what else into a single song, and J-pop. It's got its own flavor, but it's also riding the same wave of experimentation. Now, here's where it gets messy. You've got K-pop idols dropping tracks in Japanese, and they're suddenly labeled as J-pop? That's like calling a pizza a vegetable because it's got tomato sauce. And let's not even start on the whole language debacle. If a K-pop song gets an English version, does it magically transform into Western pop? I don't think so. It's not just about the language. It's about where the music's coming from, its style, and its soul. The music industry's got a serious case of tunnel vision when it comes to categorizing music. You've got your pop tab on Apple Music, and it's like a VIP club for Western artists. But then, K-pop and J-pop get shoved into their own corners, like they're not part of the pop scene, that's just lazy. These music platforms are gatekeeping the pop label. It's like saying, you're not from the West? Sorry, you can't sit with us. It reeks of exclusivity and a whiff of cultural elitism. Why can't a song from K-pop or J-pop just be pop? No prefix needed. In short, K-pop and J-pop are more than genres. They're dynamic, ever-evolving industries that refuse to be pigeonholed. It's time we recognize that and stop trying to put them in boxes that don't fit anymore. Music's evolving, and our labels need to catch up. 6. It's 2024, and people still see Asia as one country. The whole Asia is one big country vibe is as ridiculous as it sounds. It's like saying Europe is just one big pizza place because they all love cheese. Asia's got a whopping 48 countries, each with its own flavor of culture, language, and traditions. So when K-pop crossed over from South Korea to, say, Japan or China, that was already hitting the international stage. It's not like K-pop had to wait for a stamp of approval from the Western world to be considered global, and this whole collectivist stereotype? Please. It's like saying all fruit is the same because it's not meat. The cultural diversity across Asia is massive. You've got everything from the nomadic vibes in Mongolia to the tech hustle of Tokyo. To lump it all together is just lazy thinking. This whole America is the default mindset. It's a classic case of egocentrism. It's like thinking the world revolves around your hometown because that's all you know. But newsflash. There's a whole world out there beyond the US borders. And yeah, they're part of the international scene too. Asia is not a monolith. K-pop has been international since it left South Korea. It doesn't need the Western approval to be called international. 7. Male idols also get sexualized. Twitter is a place where people go to lose their minds. It's absolutely bankers how some fans go into a frenzy the moment a male idol decides to pop a few buttons or ditch the shirt. Like, hello? Ever heard of a beach? The way some people drool over these idols on social media is downright bizarre. They're human beings, not slabs of meat at a butcher shop. And sure, these idols might be a feast for the eyes, but that doesn't mean the internet needs to go overboard with the sexualization and turn into a free-for-all of thirsty comments. It's straight up weird. Just because they're grown-ups doesn't make it any less cringy or creepy. The explicit stuff I see on Twitter? Some fans must have misplaced their filters or maybe never had one to begin with. The whole situation is a mess. And it's not just a K-pop problem, it's an everywhere problem. There's this idea that guys should take these comments as compliments, but that's a load of nonsense. Not all idols are going to be comfortable with being objectified, and why should they be? A simple he's hot or he's sexy is more than enough, but fans love to run the extra mile.